stopped, as we always do. And I said, well, there's this passage I don't understand. And she said, I don't understand it either. And I said, yes, but you've been studying this book for 30 years. She says, yes, but I don't understand it. And that's her brilliance and her charm. In all the years that I've known her, I've never been of the view that she's believed she understands anything completely. And whenever she comes back to it, she tries to come back to it anew. I'm sure the first time she read the books of Exodus and Numbers were as a little girl. She now comes to these works as a mature scholar. To talk on in the wilderness of Sinai, Moses as lawgiver and founder, please welcome Professor Ronna.
Thank you so much, Stuart. That was very nice. I hope it's all true. I'll allow your thanks to the Miller Center, the Stanford line. It's a great pleasure to be here. I was going to begin, and I think I will still begin, with a very brief statement from Freud's book, Moses and Monotheism, which asks the right question, although I'm not sure he has the right answer to it. But Freud asks, how is it possible for a single man to develop such extraordinary effectiveness that he can create out of indifferent individuals and families one people, can stamp this people with its definite character, and determine its fate for millennia to come? That, of course, is the question about any founder, and Freud asked about Moses. But then I came upon another quotation that seems an even more specifically appropriate way to begin. And this is from the German poet Heinrich Heine, who wrote a book of confessions, he called it. I think it was 1854. And the line I had originally found quoted goes like this. I love this one. How small Sinai appears when Moses stands upon it. So I searched for this book, The Confessions, and I found a translation of it. And this is what Heine writes. How little Mount Sinai appears when Moses stands on top of it. That peak is only the pedestal for Moses' feet. His head towers up to heaven where he speaks with God. God forgive my sin, but at times, it seemed to me that the Mosaic God was only a gleaming reflection of Moses himself, whom he so much resembles in his wrath and his love. It would be a great sin, it would be anthropomorphism, to equate God and his prophet, but the similarity is striking. So let me begin. The Torah is by tradition understood to be the five books of Moses. Am I speaking? Can you hear me back? Or not too loud? It's by tradition understood to be the five books of Moses, as if the role of political founder could only be completed by authorship of the founding text. Deuteronomy, in any case, the last of the five books, takes the form of a speech or a series of speeches delivered by Moses before his death in the plains of Moab, just outside the Promised Land. In these speeches, he recounts the epic tale of his founding of the Hebrew people, narrated in the book of Exodus and continued in the book of Numbers. My reflections this afternoon on that epic tale have two sources of inspiration. One, in Machiavelli's explicit appeal to Moses as the model of a ruler in a time of crisis. The other, in Plato's conception of the lawgiver who must withdraw in order to assure the authority of the law he leaves behind. These two sources are related to different aspects of the role of Moses as founder. On the one hand, he must lead a group of individuals just released from slavery and without the habits of freedom, a group with no structure of association and no land of their own, compelled to wander through the wilderness, facing hunger and thirst, external enemies and internal dissension, with little confidence in themselves or their guide, and little understanding of their destination and its meaning. Such extraordinary conditions, which might call for cold-blooded decisions and ruthless deeds, test the prudence and determination of a leader. That is the Moses Machiavelli holds up as the exemplar of a new prince prepared to undertake whatever action is necessary in order to establish his new laws and orders. Leading the journey through the wilderness, however, is only the preliminary aspect of Moses' role as founder. His ultimate task is to forge the enduring identity of a people through his transmission of the divine law. As a ruler in crisis, Moses must be a powerful presence long enough to establish the law. But that requires, in turn, his departure as lawgiver, along with the departure of God, who is the source of the law. This is a theme Plato develops in a dialogue devoted to the question, what is the statesman? The pursuit of that question leads to a myth about cosmic history as it alternates between two epics. In one, a god governs and exercises providential care for the whole. Then a cataclysmic reversal ushers in a contrary cycle when the divine pilot lets go of the rudder of the universe and withdraws to the lookout, leaving the cosmos on its own. The departure of God becomes a model in the subsequent discussion of rule by law. In contrast with the statesman, who must be present on the spot to deal with each particular situation, the legislator must depart in deference to the sovereign law. Herodotus, Odysseus and Herodotus are in the background here. Herodotus provides an illustration in his report on the Athenian legislator Solon, who departed from Athens for 10 years after promulgating his code of law with the order that none of the laws could be changed in his absence. In the biblical epic, Moses leads the Hebrew people through 40 years of wandering in the wilderness, only to be excluded in the end from entrance into the promised land. This exclusion, in the Platonic understanding of things, would express a necessity of political life, more specifically, life under the law. It is presented in the biblical narrative, however, as God's punishment for a lack of faith Moses displays at a particular moment of weakness. In the portrayal of Moses as leader, similarly, the ruthless deeds called for in circumstances of crisis are regularly presented as actions commanded or performed by God, as punishment of those who have turned away from him and his law. The biblical narrative thus seems to allow for two distinct threads of interpretation, one in terms of political necessity, the other in a moral, theological language of divine punishment. It is Moses himself, on a number of occasions, who is responsible for translating the former into the latter. At those moments, he is portrayed legitimating his decisions or actions by an appeal to divine authority for which no independent evidence is supplied, even or especially when it would have had an obvious place in the narrative. I hope you'll see as we go on by examples, if that's not clear yet, I hope it will be. In Platonic terms, Moses is represented employing a, quote, noble lie, what Plato calls a noble lie. Of course, it wouldn't be truly noble or beautiful unless in the service of an end that is good. Moses may be the founder of the Hebrew people, but he is not there at the beginning. The origin lies in Abraham, who is commanded by God to leave his father's house and to set out for a land where he will be made a great nation with a great name. Precisely as the father of a nation, however, Abraham cannot be the founder. This people may be an extended family, but the blood relation is not the principle of its identity. That principle is the law, and Abraham cannot be the founder because he is not the lawgiver. Now, Abraham does seem fit for that role at one moment in particular, when he confronts God deliberating about how to deal with the wickedness of Sodom and Gomorrah. Abraham protests against sweeping away the righteous with the wicked. If there were 50 righteous men in the city, would a just God destroy it? He argues his way with God down to 10. Even that is not enough. Still, in the process, Abraham establishes a principle of justice and negotiates with God to live up to it. That Abraham, however, looks altogether different from the one who accepts God's ultimate and incomprehensible demand to sacrifice his son, the son born miraculously in fulfillment of God's promise. Abraham submits without questioning, and thus becomes the model of obedient faith. But there's something very disconcerting in the account of this trial. God sends an angel to stop Abraham from carrying out the deed. God does not appear himself. In fact, he never again speaks with Abraham after this event. Is it possible, I wonder, that Abraham's obedient faith, his proof of himself as God-fearing, is a failure of the test God imposed upon him? If the aim of this trial were to pick out the potential lawgiver, perhaps that would require someone willing to stand up against God and hold him to a standard of humanly comprehensible justice and rationality. Abraham's descendants will have to endure 400 years of enslavement before that individual arises. The emergence of that individual out of the world of slavery begins, like so many myths, with an almost miraculous rescue and a change of identity. Pharaoh's edict of death to all sons of the Hebrew slaves brings about the removal of Moses from his natural family and transference to the royal family, which ironically nurtures the future liberator it fears. To begin playing out his fate, Moses must depart from his adopted home, but that results from a deed that displays his distinctive character. A quote from Exodus, "It came to pass in those days when Moses was grown up that he went out unto his brethren and looked on their burdens, and he saw an Egyptian smiting a Hebrew, one of his brethren." It's not clear, the Bible does not make clear whether Moses knows that it's his brethren. "He looked this way and that way," the report continues, "and when he saw there was no man, he smote the Egyptian and hid him in the sand." Moses may act boldly out of anger at injustice, yet he does look first this way and that way. He acts with some caution or prudence. Still, the very next day, when he discovers two Hebrew men fighting each other and tries to stop them, one charges, "Who made thee a ruler and judge over us? Thinkest thou to kill me as thou didst kill the Egyptian?" The simple sequence of this story, foreign oppression replaced by internal dissension, foreshadows precisely the pattern of the challenges Moses faces on the path ahead. Forced to flee from Egypt, Moses reaches Midian, where he finds the seven daughters of the priest at the well and drives off the shepherds who are preventing them from watering their flocks. Taken, it seems, to be an Egyptian of some rank, he earns the hand of one of the girls in marriage and names their firstborn son Gershom, for he explains, "I have been a stranger, Ger, in a strange land." He learns of the mission that will bring him to the land of his birth, where, of course, he was already a stranger, while watching the flock of his father-in-law on Mount Horeb, which is, according to most of the scholars, Mount Sinai. Moses first finds God, that is, or God finds him, in a place that will mark the peak moment of their association. Now, you all know this story I'm about to tell, but when you read it again, the nuances are, I find, remarkably profound. Moses comes upon a bush ablaze with flames and not consumed. He is at first filled with wonder and draws aside to look. Only then does God speak out to him, "Moses, Moses," and he said, "Here am I." God announces himself, "I am the God of thy fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob." And Moses hides his face. His first reaction is fear, but his unwillingness to look is a premonition of the truth of the hidden God, which he has yet to learn. God explains that he has heard the cry of the children of Israel and has chosen Moses to bring them forth out of Egypt. "Who am I?" Moses responds, humbled presumably by the magnitude of the task. But his question, taken literally, is an expression of wonder or doubt about his self-identity. While God assures him that he will be at his side, Moses immediately begins thinking about the political problem of legitimating his authority. What should he tell the children of Israel when he says he has been sent by God and they ask, "What is his name?" The political problem turns into the ontological question, what is God? When God responds to Moses' query by declaring his mysterious name, I am that I am. Moses is to tell the children of Israel, I am hath sent me unto you. He must take on the role of leader, appealing to the support of a God who is beyond human comprehension. Moses understandably protests his insufficiency. Even when God shows him the magic that will convince the people, he worries, I am not a man of words. I am slow of speech and of slow tongue. God promises, I will be thy mouth. But Moses provokes God's anger by continuing to insist that there are others more fitting. In the process, however, and I'm beginning to see how deliberate this is, Moses inspires a new plan in God's mind. Aaron, the brother of Moses, can be his spokesman. But as God himself observes, if Aaron is the prophet, Moses would stand in the place of God. God tells Moses that. God concludes his first exchange with Moses by acknowledging how much he will be hidden behind his human representative. In the court of Pharaoh, however, where Moses and Aaron begin their mission, they are nothing but the means of God implementing his design. And that design seems to aim at the display of God's power as much as at the liberation of the Hebrew people. God informs Moses in advance of his plan. He will inflict destruction on Pharaoh and the Egyptians for refusing to let the people go, then repeatedly harden Pharaoh's heart each time he repents, so he will refuse once again, all in order to exhibit to the fullest his great signs and wonders. The account that follows, the terrible sequence of the 10 plagues, culminating in the death of the firstborn sons of the Egyptians and then the drowning of Pharaoh and all his charioteers, involves God's most intense intervention in human history since the creation of the universe. Divine miracles, perhaps, are the sole way of explaining liberation after 4 centuries of enslavement by a powerful oppressor. It is only once the children of Israel find themselves wandering in the wilderness that God begins to recede, and Moses becomes far more than an intermediary. Life in the wilderness brings constant crises of hunger and thirst, which make the people look back nostalgically to their enslavement. Would that we had died by the hand of the Lord in the land of Egypt when we sat by the flesh pots, when we did eat bread to the full. This murmuring goes on until the end. It is not overcome or resolved by the dramatic experience that marks the climax of the journey, which comes surprisingly early. I quote, in the 3rd month after the children of Israel were gone forth from the land of Egypt, the same day they came unto the wilderness of Sinai. While the people encamp before the mountain, Moses goes up and hears God issuing his promise. If the children of Israel keep his commandment, they will be unto him a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. In 3 days, God announces, he will descend to the top of the mountain and Moses will go up until they reach a meeting point. On the appointed day, the mountain resounds with thunder and flashes with lightning. A great horn sounds out and the people tremble. God begins speaking, no audience is specified. Starting with the fundamental principle, I am the Lord thy God who brought thee out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. Thou shalt have no other gods before me. At the end, the people perceive the thunder and lightning and the sound of the horn. Absolutely nothing is said about hearing the words of God's speech. The revelation is for them a theatrical display, which induces terror. They beg Moses to serve as their intermediary, to stand between them and the divine presence. Moses accepts the role and enters into solitary communion with God on the mountaintop for 40 days and 40 nights until finally he is given the law in the form of 2 tables of stone written with the finger of God. While Moses is absorbed in private converse with God, the narrative takes us back to the camp below to witness conditions in the absence of the leader. the tension between the demands on Moses as ruler of the people in a period of crisis and Moses as transmitter of the divine law could not be captured more vividly. Gathered around Aaron, the people demand, "Make us a god, this Moses who brought us out of the land of Egypt. We know not what has become of him." With the withdrawal of Moses, there is not even a memory of God or his role in the liberation from slavery. Aaron puts up no resistance to the people's demand. Out of the golden ornaments they give him, he fashions a molten calf and declares, "This is thy God, O Israel, who brought thee out of the land of Egypt." The backsliding of the people in the absence of their leader is a rejection of the fundamental principle of the law Moses just received. Thou shalt have no other gods before me. Back on the mountaintop, God, who sees from afar, orders Moses to go down. "Thy people that thou hast brought out of the land of Egypt have turned aside quickly out of the way which I commanded them. Let me alone," God demands, "that my wrath may wax hot against them and I may consume them, and I will make of thee a great nation." Moses ignores the offer for special treatment now and on every occasion, repeated occasion, when God proposes it. Instead, he confronts God with the masterful rhetoric a wise minister would use with an all-powerful tyrant. "Why doth thy wrath wax hot against thy people that thou hast brought forth with great power and a mighty hand?" He appeals first to God's self-interest in his own reputation. "The Egyptians will say this all-powerful God brought his people forth only to slay them on the mountain." And then he reminds God of the demands of justice, which bind him to the promises he made to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Moses assuages the wrath of God, but only to embody it himself when he descends and sees the people dancing around the golden calf. His anger waxes hot, the exact same formula that God had just used of himself. He dashes the tables of stone to pieces. Moses, who had complete presence of mind when hearing of these events from God, is aroused to anger now when he sees the scene with his own eye. Or is it possible that his passionate reaction is only an imitation of divine wrath? It proves in any case to be of the greatest benefit, since the destruction of the tables of the law will necessitate a second ascent to God, which Moses undertakes with a far deeper understanding of his task. At the moment, he grinds the idol to dust, strews it in water, which he makes the children of Israel drink. In the desert, they drank bitter water or none at all. Now the bitter water they drink is the remains of their false god. Turning to Aaron, Moses offers him a way out, asking, "What did this people do to you that you should bring such a sin upon them?" Aaron absolves himself of all responsibility. "I cast their gold ornaments into the fire," he explains, "and there came out this calf." Moses does not say a word. This is not about his brother, who in any case may still be a necessary ally. Facing the decisive crisis of his life as leader and founder, Moses takes a stand at the gate of the camp and makes a declaration. "Whoso is on the Lord's side, let him come unto me." And the narrative continues, "All the sons of Levi gathered themselves together unto him." In the report of the demand for the golden calf, no division of the people was mentioned. They were all involved. Moses creates that division now. He speaks as if he is splitting off the innocent from the guilty, but there were no innocent. Either, Moses must realize, he has to give up his project of founding altogether, or he must artificially imitate a moral division of guilty from innocent, which is in reality a political division. Those on the Lord's side are those on the side of Moses, and that is his own tribe, which has allied itself with him against all the rest. Moses begins speaking to his fellow Levites. "Thus saith the Lord, the God of Israel." But we have heard absolutely nothing of God issuing the order Moses now devises on his own. even though we were just witnesses to his whole exchange with God. Put ye every man his sword upon his thigh, Moses commands his tribesmen, and go to and fro from gate to gate throughout the camp, and slay every man his brother, every man his companion, every man his neighbor. What Moses instigates is not the punishment of the guilty by the innocent. It is civil war. Confronting the weakness and failure of his people, Moses introduces fratricide on a grand scale, a primal terror that will usher in a new order to be instituted with the transmission of the divine law. The account reaches a terse conclusion. And the sons of Levi did according to the word of Moses, and there fell of the people that day about 3,000 men. On the day following the massacre, Moses now tells the people that he will return to God and try to make atonement for their sin. Apparently, he couldn't do that in the beginning. And if God is not willing to forgive this wayward people, Moses demands of him, blot me out of thy book, which thou hast written. Just as Moses refused God's offer to make of him a new nation, God now refuses Moses' offer of self-sacrifice and insists instead on just punishment. Whoever has sinned against me, him will I blot out of my book. Indeed, we are told at the whole end of the whole episode that the Lord smote the people because they made the calf which Aaron made. This ambiguous description of responsibility raises a question about the justice of God's requital, which apparently does not affect Aaron, who still has many years of life ahead. In any case, and this is what really struck me, the deed referred to is never described in the biblical narrative. In the absence of that description, God's smiting of those who betrayed him cannot help but look like an alternative interpretation of the violence Moses ordered on his own authority. Acting out of recognition of a political necessity, Moses motivated the Levites by a noble lie, attributing his command to the word of God. But on this occasion, the biblical authors do not simply represent a noble lie used by Moses. They seem to construct one of their own by translating his deed into a report of divine punishment of the idolaters. After the turning point of the golden calf episode, God is no longer willing to be present himself with the people, lest he explains, I consume them in a way. The children of Israel mourn at being abandoned. Moses, on the other hand, is engaged at the same time in his most intimate association with God, in the tent of meeting outside the camp. Moses comes to this extended encounter shaped by the political experiences that had forced him to recognize his own ignorance. To fulfill his role as lawgiver, he now desires knowledge of the ultimate reality behind the law. Since I have found grace in your sight, Moses reminds God, show me thy ways, that I may know thee, to the end that I might find grace in thy sight and consider that this nation is thy people. Let me repeat that. That's a very important sentence, and it sounds like it's grammatically incorrect. Since I have found grace in your sight, show me thy ways, that I may know thee, to the end that I might find grace in thy sight and consider that this nation is thy people. It is according to Moses because he has already found grace in God's sight, that God should now reveal his ways to him. Even if Moses were a mere executor of God's will, Machiavelli remarks, quote, he should be admired if only for that grace which made him deserving of speaking with God. I discovered with that what a very careful reader of the Bible I think Machiavelli is. Yet, Moses asks for the divine revelation in order that he might find grace in the eyes of God. This must be grace on a new basis, on the grounds of knowledge, not knowledge desired for its own sake. Moses seeks this knowledge as a condition for his nation to become the people of God, which is possible only if its identity is forged by a lawgiver who understands God's ways. God does not address Moses' plea for knowledge. He only pledges his support. My presence shall go with thee. If not, Moses instructs God, do not carry us up at all. Moses is still concerned, as he was at the beginning, with the political problem of appearing in the eyes of those he governs to have divine support. But when God confirms his promise to be present, Moses is emboldened and makes another appeal to God to reveal himself. Show me, I pray thee, thy glory. This is a central passage for Maimonides, who sees in these two requests for divine revelation a difference of the utmost significance. The glory of God that Moses wishes to be shown is the essence and the true reality of the divine. God does not satisfy that desire for knowledge. Instead, he offers to make his goodness pass before Moses, which, according to Maimonides, is a response to Moses' first request to be shown God's ways. For the ways of God are the attributes of his actions, merciful, gracious, and long-suffering. And that, Maimonides argues, is the knowledge needed to emulate the actions required for the governance of cities. God reveals himself to Moses in the end by proclaiming the divine name, as he first did from the burning bush. I will be gracious to whom I will be gracious, and will show mercy on whom I will show mercy. The only disclosure of the reality of God is the declaration of his incomprehensible grace. Now, this concealment of God is absolutely necessary for those who will be subject to his law, who cannot go behind the back of the law with a claim to wisdom about its ultimate grounds, which would make the commandments and prohibitions superfluous. The lawgiver, in contrast, would seem to need just such knowledge of the principles and purposes of the law, which must be converted into commandments and prohibitions. And yet, God does not disclose to Moses the knowledge he wants, at least not in the way he thinks he wants it. Thou canst not see my face, God warns, for man shall not see me and live. Moses is granted a second best. He will be placed in a cleft of the rock where he can see God's back as his glory passes by. I think that's the crucial message of the book of Exodus. There's no direct contemplation of God's glory, only the vision of his back as he withdraws. God can disclose his ways to the lawgiver only by refusing direct access to his essence. The departing God is the necessary condition for the transmission, or perhaps the creation, of the divine law. Moses remains in solitary association with God once again for 40 days and 40 nights. In the end, God tells him, quote, write thou these words. Moses should write the words. For after the tenor of these words, I have made a covenant with thee and with Israel. In his first colloquy with God, before the incident of the golden calf, Moses was a passive recipient of the tables of stone written with the finger of God. Now Moses is himself the author of the law. God is only the inspiration. When Moses descends from the mountain, his face gives forth beams of light. The blinding glory of God, which Moses saw only as the back of the withdrawing God, seems to have passed on to the lawgiver. Last section, I want to move on briefly to Numbers because some new developments that we need to reach a conclusion. Moses' double ascent on Mount Sinai coincides with, or rather frames, the episode of the golden calf. The high point of the experience of Moses as lawgiver frames the low point for the children of Israel. Their experience of neediness and anxiety as presented in the book of Exodus, concerns the most basic level of existence. They have been brought out of slavery, they fear, only to die of hunger and thirst in the wilderness. When the narration continues in the book of Numbers, it takes on a darker tone. A sense of weariness weighs on everyone. After the episode of Sinai, we should remember, 38 years of struggle still lie ahead. But beyond hunger, thirst, and weariness, a new set of challenges emerges. Moses must deal not only with a slavish people, but now with a rebellious elite. In responding to the worship of the golden calf, Moses pitted the tribe of Levites against all the others. Now he faces resentment against his authority on the part of his fellow tribesmen, even at one point his own brother and sister. This theme comes to a climax in the rebellion of Korah, one of the princes of the Levites, who gathers 250, quote, men of renown, and leads the charge against Moses and Aaron. All the congregation are holy, they protest. It's bad enough that you brought us into the wilderness to kill us. Must you then make yourself a prince over us? The very complicated story that follows. I originally had the story, but you'd be here for another hour or so. We can talk about it later, maybe. Very complicated story. Displays an especially terrifying translation of political necessity into divine punishment, eventually reaching a catastrophic conclusion with a plague that takes 14,700 lives. Suffice it to say that Machiavelli's comment, usually taken as an allusion to the episode of the golden calf, seems especially fitting here. I quote, "Whoever reads the Bible judiciously will see that since he wishes his laws and orders to go forward, Moses was forced to kill infinite men who, moved by nothing other than envy, were opposed to his plans." These princes of the people may resent the authority of Moses and Aaron, but at the same time, they share in the slavishness that makes the whole generation unfit for entry into the new land. That situation is vividly portrayed in the story of the spy mission to Canaan. 12 men of the highest rank, one from each tribe, are sent out to investigate the land promised by God. After 40 days, they return, demoralized. Two of them, Joshua and Caleb, try to inspire confidence. This land of milk and honey will be theirs if the Lord delights in them. But all the others spread terror and despair with their report that the inhabitants of the new land are giants, while they felt like grasshoppers. It's a great image, isn't it? Angered at their lack of trust, God threatens once again to destroy his people and save only Moses, while Moses once again exhorts God to think of his reputation and to remember his self-proclaimed loving kindness. God compromises. He will not destroy the whole people, but all those who doubted him are now condemned to 40 years in the wilderness. No one over 20 years old is to enter the promised land. A people so imbued with the habits of slavery that even the most elite see themselves as grasshoppers cannot be the subjects of a new order in a new land. The presentation of that political necessity as divine punishment for lack of faith looks as if it could be another element in the complex noble lie of the founding. In any event, that punishment for lack of trust in God's support serves to bring about precisely what political reality requires. Last step here. The exclusion of the original generation from the new land with a new order has its counterpart in the fate of the founder. The decisive event is recounted in chapter 20 of the book of Numbers. At this very dark moment, the wanderers have reached the wilderness of Zin. In the beginning of the chapter, we hear that Miriam died there and was buried. At the end, Moses ascends to a mountaintop where he's stripped of his priestly garment and dies. In between, Moses is warned of his imminent death. Once again, there's no water, and the congregation, full of fear and bitterness, blame their leaders. God appears and orders Moses to take his rod, assemble the whole congregation, and before their eyes speak to the rock, which will give forth water. Moses takes the rod and gathers the congregation as commanded, but then expresses all his frustration and exhaustion. "Hear now, you rebels, are we to bring you forth water out of this rock?" Moses smote the rock with his rod twice, we are told, and water came forth. But God immediately appears and addresses Moses and Aaron. "Because ye believe not in me to sanctify me in the eyes of the children of Israel, therefore ye shall not bring this assembly into the land which I have given them." Now, it does seem as if Moses has lost patience with his people and trust in the power of God, or frustration with his dependence on it. He has, after all, or will have, spent 40 years hearing these complaints until the age of 120. But for just this reason, commentators have long been disturbed by the disparity between his momentary lapse and the divine punishment it provokes, barring Moses from the destination to which all his labors have led. However questionable the justice of that punishment may be, it does coincide perfectly with a fundamental necessity. If the divine law is to have sovereign authority, the lawgiver cannot be present as a potential source of appeal behind the back of the law. In imitation of God's concealment of himself, the lawgiver and founder must withdraw and leave behind what he has founded. The necessary absence of the founder, which is presented in the narrative as the product of divine punishment, is confirmed in the last chapter of Deuteronomy. "Moses, the servant of the Lord, died in Moab, and no man knoweth of his sepulcher unto this day."
Thank you. conflict of ideas. So are you saying the fact that God withdraws is no longer a personal badge, the laws are set in motion?
So I'm torn, very interesting, and you're absolutely right that I guess what you could say, the cosmological withdrawal of God for deism, when you read Exodus and Numbers, it's a political version of the same structure. That's how I think of it. That's absolutely right that we're saying. And what's interesting, just the tone and the way of the whole thing is, how much there is some kind of personal, whatever this God is, there's a very deeply personal relation only between Moses and God. Isn't it interesting? Like I was saying, at the very, there's that one passage, I don't remember the chapter right now off the top of my head, it must be like 33 or something like that, of Exodus. There's this one passage where God withdraws explicitly from the people. He says, I will consume them. He's still filled with wrath. If I'm present to them, I will consume them. He withdraws. The people mourn. We're told that they mourn because they're abandoned. And at the very same time, there's Moses speaking to God face to face. It's a remarkable statement that Moses spoke to God face to face. So there's a very intimate, I think this is the right line, face to face as a man speaks to his friend. So, and there's also almost like a kind of dance going on where God is constantly threatening to destroy this wayward people and this stubborn people and start over again with Moses. And Moses is constantly rejecting that. And then the way this interaction works, Moses then says, destroy me. I sacrifice myself and give up myself, and God refuses. Now, one of the scholars that I respect very much and the scholar of biblical law, David Dauba, he was very interested in the patterns from the Hebrew Bible and the New Testament. Very intricate patterns he discovers. He says, which actually makes perfect sense when you think about it, that the idea of Jesus dying for the sins of humanity is implied in this moment where Moses says, let me die for the sins of this people. And God, in the Exodus chapter, refuses it. So the whole idea of Dauba has an essay called Intercession, the pattern of intercession. Why did the New Testament writers accept this pattern that the Hebrew Bible rejected?
It seems to me that Pharaonic and Athenian law was at the will of the ruler. And we have a break here. It says there is no ruler. The law was put into effect for the people. And that law is to be in effect regardless of who their leader might be.
Yeah, there's something to that. However, let me see if I can find, there's an interesting line at the end that made me think maybe I'm on the right track about this idea of political necessity rather than punishment. When Moses is told, you're not going into the promised land, his response is very interesting. I wrote in a footnote, he does not protest his fate as a punishment that outweighs the crime. You know, he should have said, what did I do that was so terrible? You know, he doesn't look at it that way at all. Instead, he offers God political advice. He says, let a man be set on the congregation who will go out before them and come in before them, so that the congregation won't be like a sheep without a shepherd, Numbers 27. So in a way, you can't do without a ruler. And I think the commentators will think that's, you know, preparing for Joshua or
there's
something.
There's a difference between a ruler and a leader.
Exactly, or a founder. Yes, that's where I would want to put it now is, you can't do without a ruler. There's some hierarchy here, but the founder would so overtop the community. He were the president as a leader. He's the one that's going to withdraw. Yeah.
Yeah, I was going to ask, is there anything in Egyptian history that might corroborate the Moses' character as being anything other than a composite character or a mythical character? It would seem that somebody would have written something about this down. Is there anything in there? I mean, to show that.
Yeah.
That might have written something.
I mean, I've read a little, but you got, I, I'm speaking here as a kind of political philosopher reading the Bible. I don't really know enough to give you an adequate answer. I see that, just the little bit I've glanced at, boy, is it controversial. You know, they start with which pharaoh? When was it? It was somewhere between, I guess, 1600 BCE and 1300 BCE, and it does sound like my little tiny glimpse of the scholarship that they do believe there was an historic event of this sort, but apparently there's no consensus, very little consensus among the scholars that I know of, about which pharaoh, when was this, and you know, you do kind of get a feel for how much is sort of mythical, right? Like, I didn't go into the details, but it's so interesting, the story of the birth of Moses. That's the one, I think, worthwhile or interesting thing in Freud's essay, Moses and Monotheism, which he got from Otto Wank. But there, the birth of Moses is like a reverse story, the myth of every hero, practically. The standard pattern is born into a royal family, removed, and then there's some kind of threat that the father issues of the death of the son, removed to a more humble family, and then eventually the hero grows up and discovers his royal origin. Oedipus fits, and all kinds of mythical heroes. But Moses is the exact opposite structure. So, you know, this, I don't know, I don't think Freud started it. I know he didn't start it, but he was into this question, who really historically was this guy Moses? He tries to make the argument that he must have been an Egyptian, because that would be the only way to explain this reversal of a pattern. You have to, but, yeah.
A couple of questions, if I may. First off, I was wondering if there is anything to God consuming his people when he is angry, and then the people being made to consume their false god, their idols.
That is so interesting. And the only reason I think that must be right, immediately my first thought is, Maimonides' project in part one of the Guide to the Perplexed, he is trying to explain all these corporeal words in the Hebrew Bible, one of them being eat, right, eat or consume. And at first he presents eat as a metaphor for knowledge because of the eating of the tree and the fruit of the tree. But then he develops it, it's all about anger, so consuming. And that's right, we talked about being consumed with anger. Consuming is the metaphor for wrath or anger. So I didn't think of that. That's a very new connection, I think, for us.
And expand, if you can, on the on Moses offering to sacrifice himself for the wrongdoings of his people.
Yeah.
Later on in the New Testament, God sending his son, Jesus. It just seems, does he deny Moses this so that he can then send Jesus later on? Or is that connection wrong? Is there something else to it?
I guess if one looks at this from the perspective of the New Testament, it does. That seems like a plausible thing. But of course, the authors of the Hebrew Bible wouldn't have seen it that way.
Right.
I think it's two different attitudes that, and also, of course, so many layers,
yeah.
The Hebrew Bible, who knows, I don't know enough to know how consistent it is. But this one occasion is so interesting because it really is the pattern of intercession where, Moses is saying, take me for this people. But my whole sense of what Moses is doing, he is so in control. It's amazing how much he's in control. That I think he knows at that moment God isn't going to destroy him. He's been speaking to God face to face like a man speaks to a friend. It's a kind of a threat. And the verse is very interesting. He says, if thou wilt forgive this people, and then it just breaks off in the middle of the verse. What? There's no consequence. But if not, destroy me, blot me out of thy book. He knows God isn't going to do that. So I don't think it's really a serious offer on Moses' part. But the deeper thing, I'm not even going to try to handle it. That's too hard to think on the spot. But you're, I'm going to think about that. I think you're onto a very deep issue. What, I mean, it would be some part of the difference between Judaism and Christianity, ultimately, that this notion of intercession is accepted in one as the central story, right, and not in the other, and rejected in, at least in the book of Exodus. I'll come back to that later. John?
Although one thing that remains that after Jesus gave the new law, he too went away, so that he wouldn't be there.
Yeah.
Just in the same way that Solomon did, just in the same way that Moses did. But what that made me think of is how different the United States was, where the people put together the laws came around to be, you know, president of Madison, Jefferson, that they did not have law, they in fact remained on the scene as were. Although you could say that they were simply taking the law from Solon, from Jesus, from Moses, and they were, in a sense, refracting it.
Yeah, no, but still, I think that's, that kind of went through my mind at one point, this contrast that you're going. It's right, I wonder, you know, I'm out of my element again, but it would be for future founding discussions, right? Very, when you get to the American founding, I mean, that would be, to me, a very interesting question to hear what people who study them say about this. Why was it possible in their case that they could still be a presence? I mean, does it have something to do with the fact that it was a group and not one individual? Is that part of it? I think it's a very interesting problem. This lady.
So it looks as if for the acceptance of the leader, I mean, Moses by children of Israel, it's necessary that there is a division within Egypt to their oppressed. And for him to be perpetually accepted as a leader, at least until a certain point, until he was brought to God, has a necessity of oppression within the wilderness in terms of being a danger to them. Then it also looks as if, in order for the law to be accepted, there was this denial of the promised land. There is always a perpetual state of, you have done wrong, and lest you forget or misbelieve again, just remember, right, that you have been denied this. So there's this ominous thing that cannot be overcome to an extent if I'm doing this correctly. But, right, even so, this is chosen, or this is referred to the state of lawlessness, and that when the leader is taken away completely. And I'm referring to the Waldenic.
Yes.
Or the state where some different laws introduced, and people themselves gather and wonder, how is it possible? How is this more beneficial?
What was the last thing you said?
An understanding of the law by one man.
Yeah.
Right? What the law is and its precepts. As opposed to either the state of lawlessness, or we can also look at it as people coming together and trying to find perhaps their own kinds of law.
Yeah, so it's not, we know it's not that democratic for sure. I mean, we can't get that out of it, right? They're not prepared for that.
But how about this ominous and unforgiveness preferred?
Yeah. I mean, there's several things you said. One is, I think, one of the very interesting themes of the whole Hebrew Bible, back to Genesis, has to do with the relation between the law and the land. In a certain way, and the whole theme of exile versus homeland, something like that. So I think that the point about Moses, his birthplace was already a stranger, right? The exile to Egypt was already a state of exile. But it goes back to the Garden of Eden, right? If life were a Garden of Eden, we would be settled, and as soon as you give up the Garden of Eden, as soon as we become human, I think, right, it's a state of expulsion. That theme, to my mind, runs through the whole Hebrew Bible, this expulsion. And I'll just give one little first appearance of it, I think. This fascinating thing that I have also another long footnote, because it would have been too long, about Cain and the founding of Cain, the slayer of his brother Abel. So the first fratricide, the first real crime, is said to be the founder of the first city. And he's the ancestor of all the inventors of the arts. So the city of arts is has this fratricidal root. But what's maybe very, I think, especially fascinating about the account is he's condemned to wander. That's presented as a punishment. That he's, that's his punishment for the fratricide. He's going to be a wanderer. And then you hear, he settled the first city with the name of the place where the city is in the land of Nod, east of Eden. And the word Nod means wandering. So it's a beautiful, I think, introduction of this theme that the first city is a city of wandering. That's the story of this people, really. And that somehow the law is a more primary principle of their identity than the land.
You mentioned how you came to respect how closely Machiavelli read this text. And we've had a number of questions which have introduced the American founding as a comparison appropriately. So I'm going to ask you this. One thinks that one looks often to Machiavelli's reflections on the Romans, or one can, in thinking about the American founding, what lessons our framers might have been drawing from Machiavelli. So I'm wondering, was Machiavelli drawing his lessons from Moses? Machiavelli on Rome a good guide to your text today?
Yeah, I really think so. But I don't know. I have to disclaim all expertise here. What brought me to the, you know, what first got me excited, I'm a Plato and Aristotle person, right? And when I see how all over Plato this idea of the withdrawal of the legislator, the withdrawal of God, and I thought how helpful that is for understanding the story of Moses. So that was my starting point. And just arbitrarily, it so happens, contingently, I began reading Machiavelli recently. And I, you know, this line is so perfect. Whoever judiciously reads the Bible will discover that he had to kill infinite men to institute his new laws and orders. So, you know, Machiavelli does leave God out of the picture. That's the major difference. But, you know, I think what most people would say, what I would certainly have said until about a week ago, that Machiavelli being a great thinker borrows stuff from the biblical stories for his own purposes. But he's not interested in giving an accurate interpretation of the biblical text. I mean, I think that would be a very sensible thing to say. But I don't believe that anymore. I actually think when I looked at the three or four places that he does specifically talk about Moses, boy, it's a very careful reading. He's picking up these nuances, like the idea of the killing the infinite numbers, 14,700, that's almost infinite, out of envy. He teaches you how to read the biblical passage. And certainly the general theme, right? How much would have to be done to accomplish something like this founding? It's not going to be peaceful. And in particular, the idea of the Civil War. And the Golden Camp episode is really the story of the Civil War. And I don't think I've plumbed the depths, by the way, by far, about why Moses really thinks that's necessary. That, I think, is very hard and worth thinking about to me. Should I get someone else to go this week?
Give it a chance.
There's two interesting aspects, I think, of the American founding. You have the story of Washington, who was and he doesn't depart, but in a way he does at the end of the second term with the said, well, I'm done, and the idea is I don't want to be a ruler. I'm impressed. But I think what's interesting about the American founding that is different from, let's say, Solon, where the Athenians were in a state of complete disarray, they said, just give us laws and allow them. And the difference between that and the American founding is we have this process of ratification, where it's actually the whole generation becomes, in effect, the founding. And they ratify the Constitution as a whole, and then when they naturally pass from the same, that serves the function of the founding, which is, I think, the reason why it never was a problem that any of these people who were present at the convention who became presidents who were named, that's not a problem.
Yeah, that makes sense. And you know, the real contrast of one way to put it is, at one point when Moses, there's so many times it goes up and down, and you know, it's complicated in those Exodus chapters. But at one point, he does read some kind of part or code of the law to the people. And this famous response of the whole group of people is, everything that you said, we will do and we will listen. And I think there's a tradition in the commentaries that, wait a minute, shouldn't it be we will listen and we will do? That this idea of we will do and we will listen is a kind of declaration of submission or obedience, right? That you have to follow the law before you really hear, understand. That's just the opposite of the way of what you're saying. So it's a contrast, right?
It's not the difference is the consent of the dog.
Exactly.
That's the new thing that's introduced.
Exactly. Yes. Yeah. That's. We wouldn't want to call it consent.
I'm very thinking with your portrayal of Moses as a political. But what it seems to me that I'm puzzled as you're not mentioning is that the examples that we've been dealing with is really law as a divine instrument, that what Moses' noble lie is about is the perpetration of the notion that this is a law from God and therefore unchangeable. Similarly, so in Plato in the Statesman, it is law that's somehow given to man. If man can't create it. And it seems to me that the fundamental change that we witness is from law as a divinely given embodiment of an unchangeable principle to something that we recognize and understand to be man-created, man-made, man-changeable, whether it's consent of the governed or legislated or otherwise. It seems to me that we're moving in two entirely different worlds when we move from the Exodus story to the American founding. We're moving in different worlds because we've taken the divinity out of the notion of the law.
Mm-hmm. So, in one respect, it's so simple, that's just plain right, you know. On the other hand, I think there are a couple of wrinkles here that complicate it. One is, and I wouldn't want to make any knockdown claim here, but in reading this last time through in the last few months, reading these chapters of Exodus, it does strike me, I purposely took out almost all my references to the biblical authors, because I don't know how much intention we ascribe to them. But there is certainly a thread running through this, suggesting how much Moses is really in charge, figuring it out, and what is this role of God exactly? It really is so receded. But still, the part where you're absolutely right is he's transmitting a law that's never to be changed. It's not open for revision. The only little wrinkle I would say on that is the whole is the role of interpretation. And you're a lawyer, so you know how much of a role that is, right? But that's in a way the whole Jewish tradition, I think, is the potential originality that comes with interpretation. Not total, because you still have to interpret that eternal law, but interpretation opens up a lot of space.
Maybe you take one more question, Ron, and
okay.
Then
you
have the reception.
Your turn.
Well,
it's
your story. You did this so much fast, but maybe I'll fix up this question. Surely one thing of great value is the fixity or certainty of law. And it looks as if part of the teaching of Herodotus and Exodus is the importance of the disengagement of the lawgiver from the law itself. But in our own circumstances, that does not appear to be necessary. And in fact, there's a continuing value in changing the law. So on the one hand, it looks as if the fixity of law is so important, but you have Congress in America and other representative bodies worldwide to change various laws. So there's a tension between what we want to be fixed and what not. And we are able to do both, it seems, with lawgivers who are here. So there seems to be something that's changed in the modern world
compare it to the ancient understanding, whether it's in Aristotle's Politics, or the Book of Exodus, or in Herodotus' Histories, etc.
Well, especially, I mean, Aristotle's Politics might be closer to our side, I think, than this, but especially this. No question, I'd have to say the same thing again. In a way, it's simple.
Yeah,
that's got to be true. However, you know, we're in a presidential campaign now, right? Where, in a way, I think that one of the important issues has to do with how fixed the principles of our founding law are, such that we are trying to renew, recover, return to the true founding principles that were fixed with our founding and make us what we are. Or, you know, to vastly oversimplify, or no, we have to revise, we have to change, they aren't adequate in themselves, and right, we make progress, and progress, I guess, is assumed to be better. But I do think in some way, right, if you stand back a little bit, this issue is always present with law, and with the idea of a founding. You know, you can always say, well, it would just be a different people if enough of the founding principles are changed. You don't have the identity of that people anymore. That people didn't last, which of course happens in human history. But if it does last, that tension seems to be intrinsic to rule by law, even in liberal democratic law.
And why the laws at the founding have this intrinsic character and authority to them. Why not change them? In the Bible, it looks as if there might be some divine inspiration to them, but
right.
Moses threw those tablets away.
Yeah.
And the only ones we have are inscribed with his handwriting, and we're not even sure what he wrote.
Yeah. But isn't it kind of amazing that even, you know, without God and in liberal democracy, rule by law, we still have at least one point of view arguing for the validity and the work of trying to return to the first principles and apply them fully, not to have to change them.
Perhaps we should thank Professor. Thank you all for coming. Our next lecture is a week from tomorrow, Tuesday at 3 o'clock, on Homer's Odyssey. And I promise it will be as exciting as this one. But there is a reception next door, and Professor Berger will be there for the next hour. So if you still have questions or comments, please go see her. Thank you very much.